have a legal request for a break.
Does it have a change for field?
30?
We can.
We can. How about a 10-minute break?
Yes.
10-minute break. Thank you.
No, you go ahead.
Thank you very much.
What we show on this is that.
That new change, that is here, it's in the structure off the wall, so he's trying to make it out of the wall.
Do they have it?
This is another subject.
Go ahead and get me prep for it, I'm sure it's coming down.
No, well, I don't know, but I'm always looking for that everyone else is in place, okay?
Yes, you can leave, so it's just late. Coming up.
Ed is gonna look at leak check field. I bet Ed is just thinking, hi, there's no leak check field on the pipe, for sure.
Do you want them both punted?
I don't know if she's there or not, this is.
Okay. I've lost all the. Feels like a work session.
It really does. I thought I'd try this angle because of the monitors. I can get their faces a little better, whereas the other side of the room, the monitors hide them. Someone actually told me that this is the press aisle, and that's what these are for. It's like, oh, so that's where they're supposed to sit. I never realized that.
Most of the desks don't work very well. This one's a little crooked. That's why I have to get this chair, because the desk works.
Gotcha. An aisle seat.
So he's still looking for some compensation. Does anybody know?
Okay, thank you, yes ma'am, if he has any questions.
Is anybody there?
It depends on the doctor.
We're ready.
the Board of Commissioners meeting back to order after a short break we took. So Jody, thank you. We are on item 13, I believe, which is DA 070074 or ABO 80001.
Yes, this is located in Commission District 24. The public hearing is for Larry Pierce regarding the denial of an easement width variance by 10 feet by the zoning board of appeals at their meeting on December 4th, 2007. The application is tabled by the Board of Commissioners on February 7th, 2008. The property is located in Lawson Manor subdivision on the north side of Lawson Drive, approximately 654 feet west of the intersection of Cedar Mill Drive, and is currently zoned LR. In this particular application, I will call your attention to one fact. Mr. Pierce's lot is smaller than was required by our, his lot is smaller than his what is required by our zoning ordinance. If this easement reduction is granted by the Board of Commissioners prior to obtaining the building permit, Mr. Pierce will still need to work with our staff to prove that his parcel qualified under one of the exemptions in our ordinance. That exemption would be a division of land occurring from the foreclosure of a deed of trust. Based on Mr. Pierce's comments, he feels very confident that this is, he will qualify under this provision. And I'll be working with the legal staff to justify that that is accurate if this is approved. And I mention all this just to bring to your attention that there is still one more bit of research required before we could say Mr. Pierce would be eligible to apply for a building permit. Thank you.
Okay, is there a motion to open the public hearing?
Second.
There's a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tan being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this appeal?
My name is Larry Pierce. I'm the owner of this particular lot in Lawson Manor subdivision. Mr. Chairman, fellow commissioners, I think this is one incident that needs to be briefed because of the legal and the litigious and venomous and vengeful procedure that has happened in this case. Now, I acquired this property in the year 2000. It was landlocked, and when I consulted an attorney, he said, well, it's really a simple matter under 44940 Code of Georgia, because property is not allowed to be landlocked in the state of Georgia. Basically, and that's the way it's always been. Now, as far as it being a simple matter, I guess that goes so much for legal advice, but it started out with Judge Galton in 03. But that was after I did due diligence in trying to talk to Mr. Lou Anderson, who was also a partner with Mr. Alan Compton, sitting back here somewhere. I'm not sure, here it is, okay, it's good. Alan Compton, they're partners in Hopeful. Now, what happened? I'm going to ask the projector to put up A, please. There's A. Right. But the property I acquired came from Kim Wise. Kim Wise was the daughter of Mr. Price. I don't know how many of you was around in 93, but that's when the infamous case of Price versus the U.S. government. And the government decided to say enough is enough, and people who has exceeded the boundaries or the 1085 line. In this case, her house was halfway to the 1085 line. When that case was over, she had to file for bankruptcy. The house was going to be removed. It wasn't really removed, it was arson in 2001. But being as may, that became a rally cry of a lot of things around the county. The Preservation Act by our governor, Crooked Deal, became law and helped out a lot of people. Now, what you see here is the subdivision in A that consisted of Mr. Lawson, who was a real estate man who developed these lots in 1958. First time I think the term was used, subdivision. They were known back in those days, before my time, as cottage lots. Therefore, there were not really any regulations to speak of. But the part that's of significance here is the end lot. And I'll try to point you here. It's the very end lot at the southernest point. Right, that's lot 32. My lot is one half of that lot next to it. Denise Wise, who is here, the Lavender lots back to the back. Her lot, there's a next one, look at here for her, third example right here. The neighbor over here, this one has a bigger mansion that's about 4,000 square feet. And the lot was in the first lot here, the property was sold to. Mr. Newt and Alan Compton bought this property, an acre and a half, on the courthouse steps in July of 1998. For $31,100. Miss Price never went there. She was quiet under doctor's care. Be as it may, their intent was to put this property to some point to make it worth a lot of money. And they did. They found an old plat that was an exhibit in 1956. It was dotted in by Mr. Lawson. And let's just say that it was brought to the court's attention. With the public outcry of what happened to Ms. Price, how do I know that things got out many times? And she moved to West Palm Beach. So the end result is that the property that was unbuildable, that took in all of lot 32 and half of the next lot, that's how mine became a triangle. And she filed for bankruptcy. The surveyor, Mr. Phillips, who was in his 70s in 1993, accidentally picked up the wrong point on the road. So on the deed and on the plat says lot 32, but on the deed was controlling, was the law. The controls and laws is the deed. And when you walked it out, when these guys walked it out, they said, my God, we've got a half a lot here that we didn't know we had. We thought we only had lot 32. We've got a lot 32 and half of one lot 31. We got an acre and a half here instead of an acre. Fantastic. So they went to work with their title attorney named Tom Lane. After a few years of writing letters to the court, this property became buildable. Did they find anybody right away? No. Real estate agent said, no way I'm touching it. But the three doctors, Duran brothers, uses it for a little hacienda. They have homes in Atlanta. They have their families in a little 5,000 square foot house, 14 rooms. Nice people. They're not here. I called them the other day. I said, Robert, can you come speak for me again? He said, Larry, you know, I just got married 2 years ago and I'm in Hawaii. So he's in Hawaii right now. So that's where he is. They bought it for $31,100 in 1998. In January of 06, they sold it for $625,000. Now, what's important about that? What's important about it is that when I bought the property, after reading about Miss Price, when I bought the school half acre, she said, well, there's a half acre, Larry, my daughter has. She'll probably sell it to you. But now, you sure you're not anything to do with these guys, or with my ex-son-in-law, Ken Wise? I said, no. I said, I live with others, but I don't know them. So when I bought that property, unbeknownst to me, Ken Wise, who was living in, he died here now, October of 06. Denise wasn't married in the lawsuit at that time. But when I bought that property, Mr. Campbell on this side, and Compton and his partner on this side, I didn't know that they were trying to get this piece from Kim. I had no knowledge. Now, what's the significance of that? They wanted to sell this property for $1 million. So I became the bad guy. I became the guy that, how did you get this property when we couldn't get it? I had enough to go in this fight. I didn't go buy it on the courthouse steps. I didn't know Ken. I didn't know anybody. But that became the beginning of the vermin of this issue. After talking with Mr. Newt Anderson many times,
Mr. Pierce, I just want to make sure you know that we've got a minute and 52 seconds left.
Oh, I didn't know that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know it was a time. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, anyway, after talking to him many times, he informed me that he was a billionaire, and so was his partner, and that if anything was going to cost me $100,000 in the easement. Now, I want to bring the court's attention to this, not the court's attention, but the attention that I had to do. Would you put up? Put up a C. They're here to talk again. We just went to court in February, put a price on the property, the easement I got. I had to pay him $1,250 after going to court for 9 years, court of appeals, three judges, starting with Judge Dahl. So after all this $75,000 that I've paid and that he's paid, they benefited by $1,250. Now, there's a term in law that says unclean hands. I want this panel to know that when they got through dissecting this property, this man here and his partner has divided this property into five deeds, okay? They have unclean hands. None of this property went through the commission. None of them went through variances, but like I'm having to do. They did it because they don't want to do it. There are no plaques in it. So right now, as it stands, I've told the county attorney, I've told Tom Brown about it, and they're aware of it. So you have these properties. Now, unclean hands means that if you do something and you contribute to it, you can't play ball. This triangle here, when he sold it to the doctors, he kept a half interest in it. This property down here that he sold to the doctors, he got for a boat dock. They live in the St. Ives and the Marietta. They have a 25-foot path here, and that's it. Now, there's a lot more to it, but you can see where the venom comes from. The case is over as of February, but they're here again. I don't know what for.
Mr. Pierce, about how much longer do you think you might need?
Just one other issue.
Two minutes.
About a minute,
2 minutes. Could I ask you to do something, please? Could you explain to the commissioners here what you're trying to accomplish and maybe not so much in the background?
Okay.
First of all, without exception, 2 more minutes.
Okay. When I first came here, out of good faith, I thought all this would be bypassed. Monies, problems, law, people. I went to the doctor. And they needed an easement for the road because I ended up having a quit claim to the road. It was given to Mr. Lawson back in 58. So I opened the gravel road, you can say. The county couldn't put down the water and the gas, so I said, okay, no problem, I'll give it to you. In that situation of doing that, the property became usable, and that's how the two houses got built. Now, when they were here at that time, it was an easement that I got called temporary, because that's what I thought it was from the doctors. When I came up, it was turned down by the first committee. Then it came to these people, and I think the only one was here at that time, the one, Mr. Cameron, he was here, but that's it. So I came up again for a review. In good faith, I said, well, I've got a temporary easement. Well, the attorney that represents these two guys and her, George and Mr. said, Mr. Pierce can't do that. He does not have a permanent easement. Oh, well, okay, can I get that? The board asked me, I said, I guess so. Come to find out, I couldn't get it because he owned a half interest in it. He wasn't going to let it go. The end result is go back to court, spend another $10,000 in February, and meanwhile we negotiated. I offered her $10,000, him $10,000, So we went from 08 that I came here. Negotiations, good faith on my part, continued, but there's nothing given. So the end result was I had to go back to court in February with the visiting judge, Howard Cook, came down again, cost to the county. We had a 2-day trial, $10,000 in fees to me. The jury comes back and says, I got to pay you $7 a square foot, which is fair market value at the time, $1,200. So I paid you. It's over. It's done. Mrs. Weiss, I got nothing of hers because I only was allowed a 10-foot. So the 10-foot that I have now.
Mr. Pierce, your 2 minutes is up, and I'm not sure we understand why you're here at this point.
Okay, I now have a legal definition from the court, and I have a legal permanent easement. Okay, permanent easement, which is an attachment, pertinence to the deed. So because I had a temporary, it was taken. Now I do have it, and they all have copies of it. So now I have a attachment, I have a legal definition given to the court as of February. And so I asked about a month ago, Mr. Bell, can something, how do you table? I don't remember the rules of order. So he said, I bring it up, we talk about it, and you have to come back.
What is it you're bringing up to talk about?
He's requesting a variance
to build on
to allow these within 10 feet rather than 20 feet so he can access his property. So he puts it out.
Yeah, when you develop a subdivision,
that's correct.
Is that all we're here to do is to grant a variance so that to 10 feet from 20 feet?
That is it. Reduce it from 20 feet down to 10.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
time's up, Mr. Pearson.
So the photograph that was there, that's the driveway.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in favor of this? Anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to this? There's 10 minutes.
I understand. I will be short and sweet. This is a statement.
Or just 1 minute.
Okay.
Yes, just going to put 12 minutes
out. Well, let's see how much I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm Denise Lear. I'm from the property at 7170 Watson Drive, which is adjacent to Mr. Pierce's property. As I understand it, what we're here to do is he would like a 10-foot variance instead of 20 feet.
I can't hear.
Instead of 20 feet, according to what you just said, it's for a driveway. My understanding was it was so he would be able to get a building permit. So now I'm confused.
Well, you can't get a building permit unless you have access to the property.
He so does. Yes. The court gave him access.
But he has to do a variance to our unified development code. Even though the court gave it to him, now we have to give a variance because our code says you have to have 20 feet. Right, Tommy?
So, can I make sure I'm understanding correctly? So, the court gave him the 10 feet easement. So now the county has to say that 10 feet is acceptable for access to his property? Is that correct?
Or driveway. He has access over what the court gave him. Now the issue is, can he have a driveway on that access?
Okay, and that's all that the 10 feet would allow for?
No, I mean, he would then be able to get a building permit to build a home on that, I would assume.
Okay, that's what I needed clarification on.
That's right, and as I mentioned in the introduction, Mary would still have procedural hurdles just to pass through our staff to show that he qualifies for the exemption based on his lot size. And that is his primary goal. Why he's here is to get sign off on a reduction in his easement with the end goal of being able to obtain a building permit.
Thank you. Okay, now I'm clear. I am opposed to the variance. I downloaded this week all the documents that were online attached to this. And my concern is if this variance is approved, I'm concerned about what type of house, what size house would be built on a 0.4 acres. I own 0.8 acres next to it. If you look at the documents provided by Mr. Pearson himself in the original and the appeal, You can see what he does with the property and the time that he has owned this property. I personally have witnessed how he likes to junk up property. If you visited the property right now, you would see an enormous amount of junk behind, thank God, behind some privacy fence down here in the lake. I don't want this variance approved. It was stated in our court, in the court hearing that took place here back in March, that a variance in a house on his property would be a major detriment to me because of where the 1085 falls. I don't believe that a house could be built that would be similar or like in nature of the rest of the community. My house is probably the oldest house in the community. It was built in 46. It was moved up here in the 50s. And it's been there ever since. All the other stuff that went on is, it went on. It had to do with the court case, not this. As far as being able to drive, he's done that. He's done that for years before he got the temporary easement from the doctors and since. So he can access his property, no problem, by vehicle as it is now. I just do not feel, he currently has the property listed for $175,000. Mine's listed for $499,000. Thank you very much, Connie. I don't want to see it happen. I think it really will be a detriment, not only to me, to the million-dollar mansion, as he put it, on the other side of me, with the doctor's own on the point, and to the rest of the people in the neighborhood. The question had been asking me why I didn't bring other neighbors, because I don't want to drag them in this mess that has gone on indefinitely. My late husband was not willing to grant him access, neither was I, and neither did the court on my side.
Excuse me,
I'm done.
Okay. How many other people wish to speak in opposition to this?
Two others.
Okay, can you do this in 2.5 minutes?
I was expecting a little bit more time, Your Honor. I thought we had 10 minutes.
10 minutes per side. If we grant 12, you'll have 6 minutes.
Would you at least give us a combination of what Mr. Pierce got?
Yeah.
Yes.
We'll add 2 minutes. It's per side. He just didn't bring another person, so it'll be 12 minutes all total. She's already used up about 5 of your 12 minutes.
So we need to add 2-2.
Yeah, can we add 2-2 at 2 minutes?
Just be conscious of the time. So we get about 3 minutes,
Yes, I can. My name is Ben Anderson. I am a partner in the Good Times LLC and the Hopeful LLC. We currently both own properties. One Hopeful owns property right to the left of Mr. Pierce, and Good Times owns one property 2 lots over from Mr. Pierce. I have to say, from what Mr. Pierce just said, I object to about 50% of what he said. Much of it is very inaccurate. I strongly oppose the variance. This application is so that Mr. Pierce can get a total lot. He currently, and it's purely for him to maximize his profit on the property. It's currently listed with a realtor. The listing specifies that it is a total lot, so he's already made the decision that he's going to witness this variance. And so it's not for him to retire on or have a happy place to live forever. It's purely to maximize the profit of his property. Now this issue has been adjudicated twice, and he has lost both times, and both times the parties have heard all the issues. It went in front of the Board of Variance, and we had a complete hearing, and they denied his application. Then in March, we had a jury trial at the Superior Court of Forsyth County, and the jury found that Mr. Pierce could have a lot that he could drive on, and so he asked Mr. Pierce asked for 20 feet, and
and the jury awarded him 10 feet so that he would have a lot to drive on, but they purposely denied giving him the 10 feet from Mrs. Weiss because they felt like a buildable lot would be extremely detrimental to Mrs. Weiss.
How do you know that they purposely did that?
Well, we filed testimony. I mean, that was the whole testimony was how it would affect Mrs. Weiss if he built the house on the property.
Is that in the order? the final order where Mr.
Yeah, Forsyth I had the final order, Mr. Richter, and I can give you a copy of that.
I mean, does it specify that the reason they gave him 10 feet instead of 20 feet was because they felt it would be detrimental?
No, they...
Can we ask a question that actually happened?
Yeah, sure.
You know, it's either time.
Yeah.
Well, that's my summary of a two-day jury trial.
Okay.
And all the questions and so forth. So he's really been denied this twice. Twice. And again, it's purely for the profit of maximizing his profits. Now, there's another question about the whether this code section 18-22 that he's asking for his variance on actually applies. It says that you need a 60-foot frontage, which we gave the doctors when we sold the properties to them. But it makes an exception for properties that are landlocked. Well, Mr. Pierce no longer has a landlocked piece of property. He has a court ordered 10-foot easement to drive on that property for the rest of his life and to any successors and heirs. So I'm not sure if that even applies to the to the situation that he's asking for. The other thing is, I looked at when the variance board answered, they sent a document showing the square footage requirements and setback requirements. And I believe the square footage requirements for a buildable lot was, this is where you have a septic tank, was 25,500 square feet. And Mr. Pierce only has a half a lot. And mind you, his lot is right in the middle of the multi-million dollar houses. And all he can do is get a little shack on there if you award him this buildable lot. But his lot is only 18,150 square feet. That's approximate. So it's much less than the county requirement of 25,500 square feet. So he fails on that issue as well. I just like to briefly address Mrs. Weiss's condition because this mostly affects her. We've got $1 million houses sitting on both sides of her. Her lot is very valuable now because it's becoming a multi-million-dollar neighborhood. When they were built for multi-million dollars, now with the recession, they're probably millions. But her lot is very, very valuable because of that. And Mr. Pierce puts a little shack type property on, and which is all he can do on this half lot. It will drastically reduce the value of her property. And I've been in this business for 30 years. My partner has extensive experience, and in my opinion, it would reduce the value of her property by at least $100,000. One last thing is, I have a safety concern. He has 10 feet, and even if you give him a variance, he's still only going to have a 10-foot roadway. The road going down to the property is only one lane wide. Now, it's my understanding the fire truck is about 10 feet wide, and there is no way a fire truck can access his property from the street. Secondly, Mrs. Weiss's house was built in the 20s, and back then, they didn't enforce the building codes, or I don't even know where the building codes were. But her property is exactly on the property line. And I saw the drawing that Mr. Pierce had of the house that he planned on putting on his property. And it showed that it was going to be 10 feet away. So that means his house is going to be 10 feet away from the his neighbor, Mrs. Weiss. And I'm told by firefighters that that is a distinct problem. So I strongly oppose this variance.
There's 21 seconds left. If someone else would like to speak.
Alice Godfrey.
So the whole case here involves the...
Oh, I'm sorry, what's your name, sir?
Alan Condon, and involves the Mr. Pierce making a profit. That's all it's about. And he has a property listed. Here's a copy of the listing in MLS for $175,000. This is not for any personal retirement home. And I don't have any time, so
If we gave you another minute and then gave Mr. Pierce another minute, is that
not sure? They're kind of rehashing the court case.
And yeah, but the court case has decided this whole thing.
The court case has decided. Did you buy this property, you and your partner here at one time? Did you buy some property
down here? We bought the point lot, yes. Lot 32 and half of lot 31.
And you sold it?
We sold 90% of it. We retained a lot in Bogot for my grandchildren.
Did you sell it for more than what you paid for it?
And more than I paid for it? Oh, yes.
So you regret your...
No, we don't have any problem with him making a profit. I'm just telling you the reason we are here. He has walked into the courtroom, and the courtroom and here with Kane saying, I just want to live in this house.
I don't think he said that to me.
He did the last year.
Well, he didn't tonight.
Well, he's always told every jury trial, we won a jury trial here in the county, then it was appealed. Let me tell you, this is the first time in Georgia that a person who bought a landlocked piece of property was granted an easement. Normally, it's when you're landlocked after you're there.
But the court did.
But the court did give him, but they also sent him back here. We had a jury trial here, and the jury only awarded him 10 feet, and none. He asked for 20, they only gave him 10, and that is in the court, from the court.
Thank you. Tom, can you, are we able to address, or counselors might have this, are we able to address the buildability of this lot tonight, or are we just talking about the...
Mr. Commissioner, I'll tell you first shot that I'm not prepared to address it this evening. There are a couple of provisions in the code that might be applicable. One of them has to do with judicial apportionment. They may very well provide an exemption to the typical lot of record analysis. Quite frankly, that's going to be a little bit of a document slog for me and Tom to get through to figure out whether, in fact, this lot was created by any sort of judicial apportionment. And there's other issues. I mean, the reality is in 1993, the county did, in fact, record the parcel or the lot that therefore effectively subdivided the parcel that Mr. Pierce lives on. And Tom and I have been going back and forth on the implications of that. So there's a little bit of work for Mr. Brown and I to do before I'm able to make a decision or at least make a recommendation to the planning director. He will make the actual decision.
All right. So whatever we do tonight, we need to address the variance. Then Mr. Pierce would have to come back, or maybe not that far, but we would have to investigate and dig into a little bit more on the buildability, if that's a word of the lot.
That's correct. If you were to grant the variance tonight, you are not granting a building.
Right. Can we have, if we were to grant the variance, can we also give direction for planning and community development in your office to look into the buildability and come back to a work session in 30 days or so?
Of course. Yes, sir.
Now, say a building of a lot depend on the type soil and sewer permit, septic permit, too. Right. It may be unbuildable by those definitions, right, or limited size when you build it.
Right.
I'd like to clarify something too. Under Georgia state law, property rights
Does it limit people whether or not they're going to build something on it, or whether they're going to sell it, or is it still giving property rights to do what they wish with their property?
I think the law makes a particular distinction as to the potential use of it.
So they can sell it, and that's perfectly legal, or they want to...
Well, they can sell it so long as they're appropriately advertising what you're getting. Yes.
Thank you.
Is there any covenants or restrictions on this property? Can anybody answer about what it can be used for, or size of houses, or style of houses, outdoor storage, or nothing?
There are setback requirements.
Right, I'm talking about visual style of home, well, because they own the property. And what I'm getting at is we cannot, and I'm not going to address some of the issues about what's kept on the property or anything, but as long as it's lawful, that's all we can discuss tonight. If it's not lawful, then you guys would have to address that with some type of a civil action.
Okay, I make a second. My only concern is...
Sir, come to the podium, please.
And I'm only going to go about 30 seconds.
My only concern is that if you give him a variance, then he's 75% of the way there.
I'll go ahead and be pretty clear. I'm a property rights person, and I'm going to do everything I can to help him build on that property.
I'm sorry.
I'm going to do everything I can to help him build a home on that property. I'm a property rights person, and I just don't want to mislead anybody.
Okay, but that's my concern, and that's why it kind of gives him three quarters of the way there, and then he is at work.
I want him to be able to use his property, and he should be able to build a house on it, and he should be able to enjoy it just like everybody else. Now, if it's not as big and pretty as the neighbors, I'm not worried about that. If the neighbors don't want it, they need to buy it.
But he doesn't own the 40-foot right-of-way, which the county code requires.
But we have a variance process that allows us to grant the variance in unusual circumstances. This is most definitely an unusual circumstance.
It's only unusual the fact that it doesn't happen.
Right. Yeah, and but, yes, sir.
Could I ask Ken Gerard why we had to, the Jurines who live on Lot 32, in order, after they bought that lot and closed it, the multi-million dollar house there, Ken Gerard required that we give, after it closed, he saw the good with 25 feet, an easement, I mean not easement, but 25 feet of frontage. He required us to give the doctor a total of 60 feet in order to get a driveway for the Jurines, which is next door. What is the difference in that? Why would we be required to give away our property for the Durons to have to put up 60 feet versus him only 20? I just would like to know, I know you remember the case.
Thanks, Mayor.
Hi,
everybody.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to grant the variance. Make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0, Commissioner Tan being absent.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to make a motion that we grant the variance to the VA 070074, AU 080001, for a easement of 10 feet rather than the required 20 feet. Also, I'd like to add, I'd like staff to come back to the August 28th. Is that enough time, Tom? A month, or do you need a little time for that? Depending on what the...
We can do that.
August 28th work session with a summary of the buildability of this lot. That probably that'd be a motion.
Mr. Mayor, might I also add, just for purposes of the record, that your motion includes the fact that this is a overturning of the ZBA decision?
Yes, this is overturning a ZBA decision, SBA 070074.
Yes, sir.
We have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-1 with Commissioner Tan being absent. Next item. Item one has been postponed. Ken, what did you have to hold business?
Mr. Chairman, I believe we had a sewer reservation agreement.
Sewer reservation. All right, Ken.
Mr. Chairman, yeah, this item is a sewer reservation agreement between Forsyth County and Spartan Investors LLC. This was a sewer reservation the Board of Commissioners approved on July 24th at a work session, but part of the of this particular transaction was unusual in that we were specifically authorizing the sewer to not be acquired until final plat. Ken, did I get that right?
That's correct.
And therefore, and I probably should have mentioned it that evening, and probably should have tried to stop it, but it just got away from me, that this really didn't need to be approved. The agreement didn't need to be approved that night. What needed to have occurred was that the board merely simply needed to have authorized him to delay getting a sewer commitment until final plat, so long as the developer makes sure, understands that he is building at risk. So what I'm going to ask you this evening, because I don't want to have an agreement that has been approved by a board, but for which we're not collecting money, that puts us in a little bit of an awkward situation. So I'm going to ask the board to rescind this agreement, but otherwise, as part of their motion, agree to allow the developer to proceed forward at risk, and for Tim Perkins to accept a letter from the developer stating they are at risk and that they proceed at risk that there's no sewer available at final plat. At final plat time, when they come back in, we'll do the comment.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no, and this motion, though, is just to rescind?
It's to rescind, yes, and accept that letter.
Yes.
Yes.
And, okay. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. Do we need another motion on that, or?
No, that covers good.
Okay, thank you. New number one, board consideration regarding settlement in the case of Jeffrey Chancellor versus Forsyth County. Okay. Come up, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Mr. County Attorney Gerard, my name is Tim Buckley, counsel retained to represent Forsyth County with regard to two lawsuits filed by Mr. Jeffrey Chance. Allegations in those lawsuits have been well publicized, as have the various rulings favorable to the county along the way. The case was mediated in May of this year. Parties reached terms which were recommended for resolution by counsel and the insurer. Claims of Mr. Chance under this resolution would be dismissed and released without further litigation or expense to the county or its insurer, and insulating the county from any further claims or claims against other county employees or agents that would risk expense or exposure to the county. Upon execution of mutual releases under the terms of the proposed resolution, without any admission of liability by the county, upon payment of settlement funds in a total amount of $325,000, $225,000 of which would be paid by the insurer, $100,000 of which would be paid by the county, the lawsuit and any and all claims by Mr. Chance in the past, previously asserted or accrued up to the time of such settlement, would be closed and released, with each party to bear their own attorney's fees and expenses. So that is the proposal to the board in terms of approval of that proposed settlement. Thank you.
Thank you. What is the pleasure of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we accept the settlement agreement in the case of Jeffrey Chance versus Forsyth County as explained to Mr. Tim Buckley.
We have a motion.
I'll do a second for discussion. What was the breakdown of the insurance company's portion of the county's portion?
The insurance company would pay $225,000 of the settlement. The county would pay $100,000.
Thank you.
You did second that. Is there any further discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent. New business number two, resolution establishing secondary metals recycler registration fee.
Mr. Chairman of the board, this was actually an item that was discussed at the July 24th work session. It was a 4-1 vote, therefore it does appropriately come back on the new business. This is actually a new fee that is imposed by state law that the sheriff of the various counties are entitled to assess on those dealers in secondhand metal recyclers. As you know, this is not only just a fee, but there's actually another component of it that talks about regulation. Think of it almost as like our pawn shops, but it's with respect to secondhand metals. We all know that in this age of certain sorts of substance abuses, a lot of ferrous and non-ferrous metals are stolen, copper, wiring, things of that nature. This is an attempt, I believe, by the General Assembly to empower sheriffs to get a better handle on that by requiring these dealers in secondhand metals to register. This is simply the fee component of that, a $200 annual fee. I believe, quite frankly, it's self-effectuating, which means you don't even need to approve this, but the sheriff has asked that you do. So this is a resolution imposing the $200 annual registration fee on secondary metal recyclers.
Councilor, you said that we don't really even need to do this, and it's already set by state law.
It is set by state law, and I believe it's self-perpetuating, which means I believe it already exists.
Mr. Chairman, I make the motion that we not approve this resolution. There's no need for us to do it, and I don't see any reason to do it. So again, the motion is to not approve this resolution.
Do you want to do it that way, or do you want to just take it off?
Yeah, dispose of the agenda. It could be taken off, it could be tabled, it could be.
I make a motion that we withdraw the motion, make a motion we withdraw this from the agenda.
And a second.
We have a motion and a second. No further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that fails 2-2 with Commissioner Tam being absent.
And that will act as an automatic postponement, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Item number three, consideration and possible approval of sewer transfer between Parker County and Roman LLC and the attorney.
On that, that's fine. Mr. Chairman, forgive me, this is new business item number three. This is actually the byproduct of a piece of litigation of which Forsyth County was a party. It pertains to a dispute between Parker Channel Homes and RBC Real Estate with respect to who owns the sewer when there has been a foreclosure of some sort or other sort of judicial process, but there was a sewer component to the development. The bank forecloses, who gets the sewer that was paid for? We were brought into the suit, of course, because we are the sewer provider, and also we have to be the ones that issue transfers of sewer between folks, and quite frankly, water sewer appropriately and with good reason would not sign off on a transfer until there had been some sort of a legal resolution. Well, there has been. Parker Chandler Homes and RBC have settled the case between them. We are not a part of that settlement. Our name is not mentioned in the settlement agreement. However, there is a full dismissal with prejudice that has already been signed and is waiting to be filed tomorrow if the Board of Commissioners will approve this sewer transfer request. And I'm asking that you do that. They've settled the differences between them. We're transferring the capacity to RBC Real Estate, which is where it belongs now.
There are a motion from the board.
Make a motion we approve reservation sewer capacity transfer request as presented by council.
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tam being absent. Administrative hearings.
No, we got
another one.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, I will ask Donna Piccarello to go ahead and introduce this item to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Just to give you a little bit of a background, on July 30th, the SPLOST 7 project team met with the awarded project manager, Carter Global Inc. Mr. Jolie provided an introduction and a short presentation to the team in regards to the firm and the recommended next steps. Just as another update, the selection committee for the architectural engineering services did meet yesterday, and we are hopeful that we'll be providing a recommendation to the project team within approximately 4 weeks. Mr. Jolie is here this evening to provide a short, very brief presentation to the board to bring you up to date. During this time, we will be requesting the following authorizations: that we proceed with the construction manager at risk delivery method, that the procurement department be authorized to issue solicitations for one, a construction manager at risk, two, for geotechnical testing at the sites using our five pre-approved firms, survey services for the sites, environmental testing if necessary, and that the proposed schedule be accepted. Thank you. Mr. Lee?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Board of Commissioners. I'd do a quick introduction of CGL for those that might get this word.
Can you speak a little more?
Sure.
Pull the mic a little. It's hard to hear.
Normally, I'm going to pull the mic down at my height, but I will. I'd like to do a real quick introduction of CGL. CGL has been focused on justice facilities for the last 37 years. We've worked in 13 countries, 49 U.S. states, and over 500 counties. Over 1,500 criminal justice assignments. We've done planning for 51 courts and in the last 10 years. And we also have an evidence-based approach to project management and planning. So the advice that we give is based on evidence, not on opinion. We also have experts in every discipline that we will bring to bear on this project. I personally have managed more than 22 projects of this size or bigger. We're local. We provide more value-added services than most. We're currently maintaining around 10 million square feet in criminal justice space, and that gives us a unique insight into managing this project for you. We also have added CBRE as a consultant. CBRE is the largest real estate firm in the United States or in the world, with 34,000 employees, so that anything that is done in the development of the courthouse and jail expansion downtown recognizes future development, and so we make positive steps towards those ends. Some of the activities that we've been involved in since we've been awarded, is that we compared the building program for the jail to 20 other jails on a square foot per bed basis. And comparing that, it was below the average, and therefore we think it's very efficient. And we're going to look to making sure the functionality of the jail is at its highest maximum. We also look at the court building program from the standpoint of looking at the court sets per building area as well, and it is below the average. So we believe we've got an efficient program that we're going to begin to confirm the week of August 13th. We built a total cost of ownership model that not only models the $100 million project cost, which we will bring this project in under, but it also models the long-term operating cost, long-term utility cost, and long-term energy cost. So we can make sure that every step we take during the whole process that we're in cognizant of that cost model and come in to beat that model. We've done a preliminary schedule, and the preliminary schedule is a 30-month schedule. We hope to have a guaranteed maximum price before this board in March. We hope to also begin demolition activities around the first of the year. It's an aggressive schedule, but a doable schedule. We've had similar experience with the same concept of schedule in a lot of other places. We looked at the delivery method in detail. And what we found, because of the site logistics and because of the type of project we're building and the unique aspect of it, that the cement risk approach protects the county as far as keep transferring the risk away from the county more than any other building type. It also has a lower probability of change orders, a high probability of owner involvement, so that the users have the, and the county has the ultimate collaboration opportunities. The cost premium is low. The resulting quality is high. Less potential for delays, and there is a high potential for local participation. So it's our recommendation that you use the CMF risk model. We used it, and we have experience of almost $1 billion in that delivery method, so we know it well. We participated in developing standard contracts for the state of Georgia under the laws that were passed for the CMF risk delivery method, so we're very familiar with that. We prepared and submitted a standard contract for review for project management services in draft form. Right now, we're completing the architectural and engineer standard contract. We're completing the CMO risk contract, and we're helping procurement with the testing program. We've also loaded up the web-based project management system, so that the designees that you appoint can access the data from this project 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in a secure manner, understanding that the designs for the jail and the courthouse are secure and should remain secure. It is a very secure site, and therefore has a protected password approach to it. The project management framework has CGL as your extension of your staff as your project manager. It also has contracts with your architect, engineer, and the CMO risk. And as an extension of your staff, we manage those contracts for you. Our approach as far as deliverables and approvals and key approvals and vetoes is for the technical team, which would be the project manager, the architect, the CMO risk, to develop the information and deliverables. Through our recommendation up to the project team, the county manager, and from there it comes to this board for approval or veto. So what's next? We have in our proposal, we did a graphic that looked like a heartbeat of the project, and basically what it says is that as you go through the timeline of the project, at each phase, during program confirmation, in the early stages, it is benchmarked against the total cost of ownership model. It's benchmarked against quality objectives, it's benchmarked against the schedule. As it goes into schematic, same thing happens, and then the results of those reviews come to you for approval. Through design and development, then the guaranteed maximum price, and then the construction. The next 20 days are crucial. There's some critical items that need to be in order to hit this 30-month schedule that need to be accomplished. One is the award of the architectural contract, which Donald talked about. We also have program confirmation, which we've already scheduled with the Sheriff's Department and the judge on August 13th. The geotechnical information, the environmental information, the surveys, and getting the testing RFPs on the street. Very important to schedule and to allow the architect to hit the ground running in schematics when that is awarded. In the next 45 days, the CMF risk award is also crucial so that we can begin working together with the CMF risk, the architect, and get the benefit of both construction and design at the same time. The also key components is getting a demolition package together and an IT infrastructure package together. So as soon as the GMP comes before you for approval, and assuming it meets all the criteria and is approved, that we can begin the building construction meeting. Some of the community meetings that we've programmed for the project, we divided it up into three different categories. One is general information of the project, where we'll have town hall meetings. We'll also put it on the website and have a website dedicated to it so the general public can see all the information relative to the project. On site logistics, more town hall meetings, especially with the downtown business owners, making sure that we're communicating with them about what's about to happen, any kind of delays or traffic issues or detours that we might have to do. Don't know if we have to do any yet, but just in case we do, we won't have those meetings early on. Again, website is included in that flow of information as well. As far as local participation, we want to rely on the Chamber of Commerce, town hall meetings, job fairs, and again, the website to transfer that information. Any questions?
Who provides the website?
We're thinking right now that we do a combination of the website that we would establish and the county would establish.
We have a website.
Yes, it'll be a tag on your website.
What do you do with the information that comes out of the town hall meetings?
It'll be acted on. We keep a log of all design issues and all procedural issues. So anything that comes out as a concern, we will address and bring to the project team for execution and recommendation.
With the construction manager risk delivery method, that the procurement department be authorized to issue solicitations for construction manager at risk, geotechnical testing at the sites, survey services, environmental testing if required, and that the proposed schedule provided is accepted.
We have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tanby. There is another item, I believe. Council.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the next item added by amendment when the agenda was adopted were two proposed resolutions seeking relief with respect to Forsyth County's water supply, one from EPD and one from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. You should have versions of both resolutions in front of you. I will tell you that I want to make sure that the exhibits are correct. My exhibits are out of order. And so I'm going to start with the EPD resolution. The EPD resolution should have, as Exhibit A, a letter to Kevin Farrell at Georgia Environmental Protection. So make sure it's not to Erwin Topper at the Corps. And if they are, then you've got the exhibit from the Corps resolution. So Exhibit A on the EPD resolution is to Kevin Farrell. Exhibit B is a letter from Commissioner Boff to Judson Turner. This resolution with respect to EPD sets forth in the preamble just some of the various backgrounds with respect to Forsyth County's need for water. It points out specifically that EPD is supposed to look at need in assessing the allocation of permit and our permit allocation that we can withdraw from the various resources that we have available. And then provides that in light of the status of the Tri-State Water Wars, it is an appropriate time for the county to in fact receive an increased allocation, and further discusses our various efforts, which of course were the attachments, Exhibits A and B, with the various letters over the years that we have sent to EPD. I don't believe that's an exhaustive list by any measure, but it is in fact two examples. Then the resolution with respect to the operative parts in Section 1 provides that if this resolution were adopted, that the Water and Sewer Department is directed to request authority from EPD to increase the county's water withdrawal limit from Lake Lanier from 16 million gallons per day, with a not to exceed monthly average of 14 million gallons per day, to 65 million gallons per day, with a not to exceed monthly average of 40 million gallons per day, provided that the director may request authority to increase the county's water withdrawal limit by a lesser amount if the director is informed by EPD that a phased increase is more likely to be accepted by the EPD. And then, of course, there's a Section 2, which is a request for increased water withdrawal limit from the Chattahoochee. In the event, number one, that EPD is unwilling to approve the full requested amount in Section 1, or the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is unwilling to authorize the county to construct an additional intake structure on Lake Lanier, and the county is unable to come to a mutually acceptable agreement with the City of Cumming regarding distribution of cost in connection with the use of the city's existing intake, the Director of Water and Sewer, Tim Perkins, is hereby directed to request from the EPD authority to withdraw from the Chattahoochee River up to 65 million gallons per day, not to exceed monthly average of 40 million gallons per day, provided that such request may be lessened proportionally by any approved withdrawal amount from Lake Lanier. So that is the first resolution I want to bring to your attention this evening, Mr. Chairman. It's up to the board whether they wish to discuss each resolution in turn or would like to present both. They are, so I'll quickly go through the second one. The second one sets forth, this is with respect to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. It too contains background. Your Exhibit A to this resolution should be a October 8th, 1987 letter to Arlen Topper, where there was a request for a county intake. Again, just with respect to the moving parts, Section 1 provides that the Director of Water and Sewer, Tim Perkins, is hereby directed to request the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers authorize the county to construct a new intake on Lake Lanier as soon as possible. And Section 2, request for water storage capacity, the Director of Water and Sewer Department is hereby directed to request the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to provide the county with appropriate storage capacity in Lake Lanier as soon as possible and returning the proposed water storage contract to the Board of Commissioners immediately upon receipt. So that would be to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers asking for permission for an intake and for our own storage contract, which we do not presently have. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I would ask this one question on Tuesday of this week. I had the good fortune of being invited and did go to the Governor's Mansion, where he gave us a briefing about water. It contained several items. I'm wondering if it would be appropriate to send copies of this, if they're approved, to him.
The board approves these as part of the motion. You can certainly direct that they be formally provided to the governor.
And there was also a Senator Tolleson who was keenly interested in this. Who I think should be, you know, informed if this is something we do. Todd, would you like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion in reference to the first resolution of the EPD that we approve the resolution by the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia, requesting an increase water withdrawal, and that a copy, if approved, is sent to the governor's office as well as Senator Paulson.
Second.
And as well as to our own
state
delegation.
You get that, Ken?
I did. It's the second.
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner.
We have a motion and we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tan being absent.
Second, I make another motion in favor of the resolution to the ACE, the resolution by the Board of Commissioners of the Forsyth County, Georgia, requesting authority to construct an intake and requesting water storage capacity, and that if this is approved, that a copy go to the governor's office as well as Senator Tolleson and our state delegate.
Second. I'll second that. We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tan being absent. And I think that concludes that, does it not, Ken?
Mr. Chairman, it is. We are ready for administrative hearings.
Administrative hearings. Well, Ken, would you give everybody an indication of who can participate in this for us, please?
Mr. Chairman, I will. The administrative hearings pertain to violations involving both licensees and sales personnel pertaining to the Forsyth County Alcohol Code. These are not public hearings in the typical sense of the word, as those of you who have been to the meeting most of the evening have seen individuals come up and be able to speak for or against. These are limited to the individuals that are either the licensee or their counsel, the salesperson or their counsel, or law enforcement, if they come up and have their questions to the board with respect to the law enforcement personnel who actually issued the citations. So there'll be an introduction by the Planning and Community Development Director, and then there'll be an administrative hearing. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. Let's see, the first one, I believe, is 1A.
Yes.
Jay Burning.
Administrative hearing AI, located in Commission District Number 3. The administrative hearing is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance.